9:15 on the morning show with Jeff and Will. We are back on this fine Monday morning, and joining us as she does every Monday morning around the time, it is the editor-in-chief of the RC Biz Journal, the Rockland County Business Journal, Tina Traster. Good morning, Tina. How are you this morning?
Good morning, County of Rockland. How are the good people of Rockland County today?
They're doing all right so far, it appears, but, well, the day is still young. Hopefully it remains that way, of course. Stay safe.
Tense times. So, reminder, this Wednesday, 8:30, Roasted Coffee Shop in Nanuet, having another meeting with the editor. Hope to see folks come on down, and we can chat. Today, we're going to talk about two stories that we put out, or three if I have time, but at least two that speak to the finances of the county and things that most of us don't go around thinking about, but that's why we're here. So there is more than a $50 billion with a B, in settlement funds from pharmaceutical companies that made and sold opioid painkillers that will be paid out over the next 18 years to state and local governments across the country. In fact, Rockland County either has already received or is scheduled to receive almost $2 million from several of the different settlements, and there's way more to come. Now, although the it is small in comparison to the big tobacco settlement of 1998, which some people may remember, or if not, here's a refresher. The tobacco payout has some lessons for those who will shepherd the opioid money for Rockland County, based on the experiences of the last three decades of the tobacco payments. Because when this money is meted out, somebody becomes in charge of it. So here in New York, for example, the AG has reached settlements of over $2.6 billion on the opioid front, with companies involved in the manufacturing, distributing, and selling of opioids. And these funds will be directed to New York communities for treatment, recovery, and prevention efforts, which, of course, makes sense. You'd like to think that, you know, the harm, that the reward of the harm would be, there'd be a relationship. But let's turn back to the early aughts when New York got its settlement and what it is that here in Rockland County, what we did with it. So The way it works is that New York passed its settlement money to the counties, and including Rockland. And in Rockland, rather than wait for the funds to trickle in year after year, some counties, including Rockland, but not all, chose to capitalize or sell the income stream from the tobacco settlement into the bond market, which enabled it to receive a large payout, all up front, less the cost of issuing the debt. And what an insider told us was, quote, the county saw a way to unload its existing debt with the proceeds of the tobacco settlement bonds. And the source said very little of the money was used for tobacco cessation or education. It was used to clear the existing debt off Rockland's books. Now, that wasn't illegal, but time, it did not, you know, go to the heart of why that settlement was there in the first place. Anyway, the county, the county set up independent public authorities. You know, we have some public authorities in this county, and we've been talking about them a lot lately. For example, Rockland Green is a public authority, and sort of the most notable one, probably with the biggest checkbook, and some others. But this was ultimately two independent public authorities that were set up. It was called the First Tobacco Asset Securitization Corporation and the Second Tobacco Asset Securitization Corporation. And as I said, they bonded rather than use this for any kind of education or health-related issues. Now, where we are today is what is relevant here in terms of where the lesson might be for opioids, for the opioid payouts that are started and will continue. Only what is a little bit different is the opioid payments have a feeling like a one-time, there's going to be a set amount, but the tobacco payments were based on ongoing sales of tobacco in perpetuity. So in 2001, the Rockland, this public authority, sold the settlement bonds for about $46.7 million. And the bonds mature in 2043, which I know sounds like a very long time away from now. And they carry an interest charge of between 4.6% and 5.75%. Line here is that when right now there's about $90 million of debt on this that the county is facing. And until or unless one figures out how to deal with this debt, we're going to be looking at a very big problem down the road, because increasingly the sales of tobacco have been going down and declining. And just one last thing here to mention is that just this past September, the bond rating company Moody's rated the Rockland, these public authorities, these 2001 bonds as near junk status. So the reckoning, you know, could be years away, but there is going to be a problem point, because it's not clear what will happen if these bonds are defaulted on. Because even though the county was allowed to do all of this, and maybe this has not yet been tested in the court, and presumably this is going to have to be paid back. So we can all put a pin in that, and we'll continue to think about that. It's a long way away, but it's still an issue. Mm. More, I guess. Now. Also, speaking of finances, we did another story that basically says that Rockland County shares far less of its sales tax revenue with towns and villages compared to neighboring counties. Mm-hmm. The elected official who this issue is a bugaboo for, more than any that I know of, is Clarkstown Councilman Don Franchino, who has been railing against this problem, saying that, you know, Clarkstown, you know, bears the brunt here because it really generates the most sales tax and doesn't get its fair share. But basically, 60% of the county's sales tax, he says that 60% of the county's sales tax is collected from the Palisades Center, the shops at Nanuet, and the miles of strip centers along 59. But the distribution of sales tax is not proportional to how it's collected. So just recently, the New York State Comptroller issued a report, as they do every year, that sheds the light on the allocations given to towns and villages across the Hudson Valley. And this is kind of interesting. So Westchester County allocates 23% of its sales tax to its municipalities, villages. And Orange County allocates an even higher amount, 26%. Does anybody want to take a guess of what Rockland allocates?
10.
Did you say 10?
I don't know. It was just a shot in the dark.
Yeah. Lower?
Lower? Oh, 7?
I think it's about 6%.
Oh, all right.
6%. Yeah, we have this 6.18%.
Oh.
So even Dutchess County 17%, Ulster County 14%.
Wow.
Ouch! Right.
Yeah.
Ouch for the towns and villages.
Hmm.
So this is an issue. The towns and supervisors know it's an issue. I guess it's what helps the county keep its taxes down, but it's at the expense of payouts that the that the towns and villages do not receive. There has been pressure over the years recently on Ed Day to take this up, and I guess there's been no traction to look at something that might be, let's just say, more equitable. So that's another thing about our finances, and you can read all of the gory details in Rockland County Business Journal on that story. Mm-hmm. And then here's another story that we put out, and this is not in Rockland County, but this to me is under the category of, hey, Rockland County, your gaze should be over there in Orange County, border of Ulster County, and take a look at what they're doing. There's the hotel market, the hospitality market in the counties north of here, particularly Ulster County and even Orange County too, is really on fire. And there's all kinds of interesting things going on in terms of hotel development and projects that pull in a lot of different aspects of what drives the hospitality market. And what we wrote about is many in Rockland are probably familiar with the City Winery. You've probably been there. I'm taking a guess. Maybe.
I have not yet. No.
Okay. It was a cool. The point about it is that not only is it a winery, which is a draw. But it was a historic. It was a reuse project.
Oh.
Okay, it was adaptive reuse is what it's called. It was an old knitting factory, textile factory, and it's been turned into a pretty impressive looking winery and a magnet for people to gather at. So the guy behind that is actually a music impresario and. A huge kind of business titan. His name is Michael Dorf, and he has bought up the remains of the former Borden Milk Factory in Walden for a song, $575,000. And he plans to turn it into a hotel, a winery, spa, gym, gallery, event venue, co-working. You know, all the things that attract hipsters, the younger generation, that breathe life into a place. And he's underway with this. He's, going through the whole approvals process up there in Orange County. But the point is that we have old historic buildings all over the place here in this county, too.
Mm-hmm.
And rather than necessarily tear them down entirely or just simply keep, putting up warehouses, Rockland County could do with projects like these. They're very inspirational, and they attract tourism, and they become and they feed on themselves, because the more there are of them, it's like a motivator for developers to look at those projects and say, yeah, this is a good site for that too. So. Lots of lessons in our publication this past week about adaptive reuse and, tobacco settlements and sales tax. So get educated, folks.
Exactly. And the best place to get educated on all those issues and more affecting Rockland business is to visit rcbizjournal.com. That's rcbizjournal.com. And we love it. That's Rockland County Business Journal. Thank you so much, Tina, for calling as you do each and every Monday. We do appreciate it. We hope you have a great week. We hope there's more stories to come, and we will talk to you next Monday.
Have a wonderful week.
You too.